We acknowledge the lands of the traditional custodians across country.
From the Noongar peoples in the west, to the Kulin and Kurnai nations of the south, and the clans of Nipaluna.
To the Ngunnawal peoples, and the Sunrise peoples of the Gadigal and Wurrumbai of the east, to the Yagara, Turrbal and Bindal peoples of the north.
And we pay our deep respects to them, to their wisdom keepers of the past, to the knowledge holders and seekers of today, and our future custodians.
Our lands nurture us as we continue the connection and our spirituality with country.
Good morning, everybody, and welcome to our 5G Wireless WAN strategy webinar. My name is David Katz. I'm the executive of mobile and network connectivity sales at Telstra. And today, I'm going to be joined by Nathan McGregor, Senior Vice President of Cradlepoint, and Phil McSherry, the Chief Technology Officer from MobileCorp. We're going to be discussing how you can harness 5G in your organization, looking at firstly how 5G is changing enterprise networks and the new use case opportunities this presents. We'll also look at how Australian enterprises are adopting 5G Wireless WAN and the use cases you can readily deploy in your organisation today, how to develop your 5G Wireless WAN roadmap, and finally, Telstra's world-first enhanced enterprise wireless offer. This webinar is going to run for 30 minutes with an added 15 minutes for Q&A at the end. And we encourage you to ask questions. We're just going to put a Slido on the screen now. So in order to answer your questions, scan the QR code or navigate to the URL screen, and we'll post the Slido URL in the chat as well. So we've allocated 15 minutes at the end of the session to answer any questions. So feel free to pop in any questions as we go to Slido, and we'll look to do our best to get to them at the end. All right, firstly, before we get started, we'd like to hear from you regarding the adoption of 5G in your organization. So on the next slide, questions that we've got are, how is your organization progressing with its 5G strategy? Have you started to look at ways to integrate 5G within your roadmap? Are you in the process of deploying 5G, or have you already been able to implement 5G in your organization? And if you can use Slido now, your responses, of course, will be anonymous, but we just kind of like to get a sense from our audience today as to where you're sitting. So if you can please go into Slido and let us know where you're at. Just give that a couple more seconds. Started. I'm a little surprised that half has not started, but let's just see as a few more people put in. I've only got 10 responses. Again, if you didn't catch that Slido, it should be in the chat. All right, we'll let that keep going. Bit more in progress now. That's probably a little bit more of what I was expecting. Let me go to the next question, because there's another question. We're also going to be discussing the role of 5G wireless connectivity in creating a resilient failover environment for your business. So if you go in, there'll be a second question. If we just go to the next slide, that second question is, what do you estimate downtime would cost to your business per hour? Again, if you go into Slido, you'll see a poll there. What will it cost you in downtime to your business per hour? Because we're going to come to the whole topic of failover and why that's so important. So it's around 40% of potentially up to 100,000. So 10% each on potentially up to 500, over 500. All right, let's, again, capture. If you haven't had a chance to do that, please do capture that because we're going to come back at the end. All right, let's start. I'd like to pass across to Nathan McGregor, Senior Vice President of Cradlepoint, to kick us off. So, Nathan, over to you.
Thanks, David. Yeah, it's a very exciting time, actually, in the wireless connectivity space. We just go quickly to the next slide. It kind of sets the scene around how it being not so long ago that we were, as an industry and as enterprise customers in Australia, really talking about the replacement of MPLS networks with SD-WAN. Kind of feels like that was a 2, maybe 3 year ago conversation with lots of deployment since then, of course. But now here we are probably, you know, a year into that journey, and it seems like we're now talking very much around the uptake of wireless WAN, not just SD-WAN. And that's largely due to the fact that now 5G is sort of becoming far more prevalent, accessible to people. And that's demonstrating to people that in fact, the network is as fast, and in many cases faster than the fixed line offerings that are available currently. So the question really is, you know, how is a wireless WAN any different to the fixed SD-WAN that we talked about? Well, the answer is when it's done well, the difference is actually minimal. You will still need a converged strategy. You'll still need security, zero touch deployment, routing capability, et cetera, that the SD-WAN traditionally would provide. But what I mean by when it is done well relates to some of the additional pieces as you're bringing wireless into that networking capability. Things like cloud management, high visibility, enterprise quality hardware and firmware, with broad capabilities that you add onto this, such as application specific path selection. And David, something you'll talk about a little later on around the splitting of virtual networks. And this is the Cradlepoint approach, bringing all of those things together to make a very robust wireless WAN capability. So it's not really our view, and certainly shared by many of the Australian enterprise customers that have gone down the path of wireless with us, is it's not good enough just to simply put an off-the-shelf wireless adapter into your network environment and say, we've got wireless covered, we're good now. It needs to be integrated into your WAN solution. So it offers a single view and much higher reliability. Again, we're going to hear a lot more about that through the course of this next 30 minutes. So our view, and it's a fair assertion, I believe, that if you are currently investing in any form of SD-WAN infrastructure refresh, you would absolutely want a 5G roadmap on that investment as a minimum. Anything you invest in now is absolutely going to hit cross paths with 5G as you get more comfortable and watching everybody else move down that path. So to the next slide, please. While we've talked about wireless WAN, there's actually many more use cases, as David inferred earlier on, around 5G. So instead of just the branch connectivity, there are many other ones like vehicle, IoT, remote work from home, and of course, for more specific industries, things like private cellular networks. But let me quickly flesh out the branch side again, just to give some more detail there to WAN. We've already reached the point where an enterprise can fully cut the cable and deploy a primary wireless as well as a failover wireless to give them their full connectivity requirements at any branch. We're beginning to see that across the world, and it's precisely what Telstra has delivered on enhanced enterprise wireless. Then there is the obvious option for, you know, the toe in the water approach, which is the existing fixed traditional primary network and wireless as a failover. Continually see that in the Australian market. That's where we've been to date. But some of the use cases on branch that maybe don't jump off the page to you is the seeing the regular use now of the day one connections. These are for the more agile business requirements. They're for either areas where you've been given a long lead time for a fixed connection, but you want a site that plan that hadn't given the runway of 3 to 4 months, that's sometimes the case. Or in fact, a temporary site requirement. Now we saw a lot of these during the pandemic when places for pop-up vaccination clinics and pop-up testing sites were, they couldn't just be a Bunnings tent out the side with a couple of trestle tables. They had to have real-time connectivity, securing patient information all the way through. So a very traditional branch, but out in car parks in my nearby one, a netball court. So those are the really strong use cases in branch or traditional branch sites. Let's touch on vehicles for a moment, because that's where flexibility of mobile really, really shines. It provides from the environments that, you know, clearly fixed just obviously can't deliver. The use cases here genuinely are almost endless. We've got everything from public transport, ticketing systems for payment, on-the-go payment, credit verification within bus and transport systems, body-worn videos on police and emergency service vehicles. And these just, you know, anything that's cloud-delivered, and in that sense, you watch all of the If you know anything about a police vehicle these days, and maybe some of you have been caught with an accidental rego check, those things are a cloud-based application that sit there always talking and chattering across a mobile network. So this vehicle, in an IoT world, we're seeing governments actually invest in this space. We're seeing governments put out things like funding programs so that you can actually go for government subsidizing some of the new innovation use cases on 5G. Why do they do that? Well, governments don't often throw money away unless we're coming up to an election. This is actually a requirement for, they see business productivity as obviously a clear driver for Australia. And we're seeing this in Singapore and the US as well. Governments think 5G, they believe 5G is going to be an access area to more productivity for business. So they're trying to invest in that so that people get new ideas off the ground and trial and test 5G capability. That's the reason they do it. But traditionally, we've seen IoT in the mobile space for quite some time. Traditionally more machine to machine, probably not high bandwidth, things like parking meter connections and the like. And definitely digital signage has been a big thing in the wireless IoT. But when we add things like autonomous guided vehicles and drones for marine life studies, just to name a few of the things that we've actually been directly involved in as Cradlepoint. So vehicle and IoT, what happens when you combine the two of them? And I really throw this one out, not because I think everybody in the audience is going to have this particular use case, but it does spark an idea around the strategy of how you might deploy 5G within your business. We're involved in a practical project where it is a service vehicle approach. So vehicles that are out on the road doing doing services of other industrial products. And they wanted to have the ability to interrogate that vehicle on the move using cloud-based IP cameras, in fact, up to 8 of them on any particular vehicle, to be able to dial in real time from a control center to check in on driver employee health, check in on how that truck is, where it is, what it's doing, what's it seeing, is it being, they had some cases where insurance and compliance were requirements for that part of business. So think about that. You've got a security CCTV camera network on the move, interrogated at any time, downloading a video at any point in time for any requirements on it. It is the tip of the iceberg in the capability of 5G for mobility use cases. Just to the next slide, please. So where do you get started on these things? Well, we believe taking a look at, if it follow the journey of absolutely a given. Just because it's fixed. David Katz, can I just get a hand up? Are you hearing me okay? I just had a quick blip. Is that, can I just get a thumbs up? Excellent. I'll continue on. Thank you. The first one is just to take a look at those more traditional fixed use cases and see if there's something that mobile can build on that, give you a better outcome. Zero day, zero touch connections, temporary networks, difficult to serve locations. It is fair to assume that many in your business don't understand the capability of wireless. So that's something that should be explored by the IT and technology teams. The second one is actually bringing a lot of business, different parts of your business into this discussion around some innovation use cases. Every business that we are talking to has innovation, digital businesses, doesn't mean that they're necessarily aligned to the IT and networking space. It's your opportunity to drive a new discussion and agenda within the business to bring different ideas and show the company what can be done with amazing innovations of 5G technology. Lead the way, show by example. So more business people across the business, I should say, different functions involved in this discussion about what networking can mean. The third thing is, once you've got those things internally, because that's your focal point within your business, is bring it to people who can bring on the experience that they've had globally and locally, and be able to show you how you can take that business concept and turn it into an architecture. Just have one more blip. I'm going to go to the last slide now and just give you some insight into what the rest of your peers are saying across APAC. We did a global study with IDC. This data is just from the APAC side, which is up to 400 companies were surveyed. And when they were asked about where wireless strategy fits into their overall business operations, 80% of them now say that they agree or strongly agree that they are currently moving towards a strategy of a primary wireless network. 80% of them. And as we mentioned before, it brings about the capability of 5G, has really brought everybody's attention to the capability here for wireless. So that's what I wanted to cover today with the audience. David, I'll hand back over to you now and take us through AEW.
All right. Hey, thanks, Nathan. You dropped us for a couple of seconds, but I think we caught 99% of what you had. So thank you for that. So thank you for sharing that. We've just heard from Nathan how 5G is enabling transformations in the way people work and the way companies do business. And so just a quick reminder, if you've got any questions from anything that Nathan said or anything you're going to hear, please remember post them into Slido and we'll get to them at the end. I'd now just like to spend a couple of minutes sharing how Telstra is investing in its network to ensure we continue to build the next generation network with the ability to deliver low latency, high bandwidth connectivity when you need it. And it's worth emphasizing that 5G will only be helpful if it exists where our customers are. And that's why coverage is so important and why Telstra continues to make significant investments in our network to offer unparalleled coverage for our customers so they can stay connected whether you're in metro, regional, or rural areas. And if you go to the next slide, I'm going to talk about kind of how 5G comes together in a moment. But what I would say is Telstra has always had and will continue to have the best network. We provide the largest network coverage. We reach 99.5% of our population. That is 1 million square kilometres more than any other provider. And to put that into real terms, it's equivalent to the size of Spain and France combined. Now, our 5G coverage within that is growing. We've got 77.5% population enjoying 5G coverage today. That's three times as many sites as our competitors. We reach more than 3,000 suburbs and we are in over 300 cities and towns. And by June, that percentage will grow to 80% coverage and we've got a plan to get to 95% by June 25. We're going to continue to innovate. You may have heard that Telstra recently announced a new world record of an extended 5G cell range of 113 kilometres. And that's a huge win for anyone in rural and regional Australia or for anyone that's just travelling around Australia. And additionally, our investment of $277 million in millimetre wave 5G spectrum will play a critical role in the future, not only as the demand for data continues to grow, but as an enabler for new enterprises and consumer use cases. Now, on the slide here, you can see a number of different functionalities that are going to start to evolve as we deliver significantly improved functionality when we move to 5G standalone that hadn't previously been possible with 4G. The one that I probably just want to touch on for a moment is network slicing, which I think will perhaps be one of the most exciting, allowing us to create a virtual end-to-end network to support specific network performance criteria through which we can offer customers up to 8 different slices each with SLAs and preferential speeds which can be used either user-defined or application-defined, which means we can dimension the network to meet your needs. Now, there are a few other features on the page. I'm not going to go into all of them all in detail, but when you look at things like beamforming or multi-user MIMO and wider channel bandwidth, you know, these will enable you to translate data far more quickly and enable you to respond faster. Now, to deliver these exciting new technologies, Telstra will continue to invest in our network and our coverage so we can support our customers on their 5G journey and ensure their business is ready to take advantage of these new opportunities. Now, if we go to the next slide, one way that Telstra continues to invest in our network is by enhancing our existing solutions to offer unique benefits for our customers. Now, hopefully you're familiar with our enterprise wireless solution that provides business grade fixed wireless connection to business sites. We've now launched enhanced enterprise wireless with added service level agreements and managed services, which will offer a 99.9% guaranteed uptime on 100 megabit bandwidth wireless connection. It's a world first offering, providing a true alternative to fixed line connectivity, offering enterprises the peace of mind that their wireless network provides reliable and robust connection, as does a fixed line option, supporting you with mission critical businesses so that your business can stay connected with confidence. Now, enhanced enterprise wireless, or EW as I'll probably refer to it, harnesses leading edge Cradlepoint technology together with MobileCorp managed service enterprise, underpinned of course by Telstra's 5G network. It's the first solution globally to offer this uptime guarantee wireless connectivity. So what does this mean for you, and how do you leverage this technology to deliver new benefits in your business? If you go to the next slide, and Nathan's spoken a little bit about this, but I guess just to reinforce it, having a wireless network with guaranteed wireless uptime opens up new opportunities and benefits for your business, avoiding common challenges faced with fixed line connectivity. And there are three examples I wanted to touch on today. And the first one is day one deployment. And often we hear from our customers that it takes too long to provision network access to new sites. But with EEW, enterprise customers can harness 5G for fast deployment and get up and running in 4 weeks with a high speed, reliable connection bandwidth and guaranteed network availability. This offers the same network speed and reliability for your mission critical business, which you would expect of fixed connectivity. And it's ideal for construction sites or retail stores, as well as outdoor venues where organizations need to set up temporary sites quickly without sacrificing on reliability or user experience. So if I take construction sites as an example, setting up fixed access for greenfield sites where not a lot of infrastructure might already exist could take up to 10 to 12 weeks. It involves site surveys, feasibility assessments, council permits, running ducting, which may need to be built for the fixed service, and even estimating the cost of a site for a tender response can take time. But with EEW, the pricing of sites can take just a few days, giving construction estimators and project managers confidence they can respond to tenders with firm costings that won't change. In retail, as another example, some customers want to move premises to cheaper locations. And again, EEW provides them with flexible arrangements where they can move their sites easily and take advantage of cheaper rents more quickly. Now, if fixed access is also required, EEW can then work in an active routing SD-WAN setup, and it can be used to quickly be redeployed to other locations. So once fixed access is in place, customers can then choose to move their EEW to a failover link, which brings me to the middle box around failover and redundancy. So downtime and disruptions can be a real threat to business. It was one of the questions we touched on earlier, which Phil's going to come to in his presentation. And EEW can be used to provide failover and redundancy to complement fixed connectivity, carrying the full load of the site for extended periods, providing peace of mind for your mission critical business and minimizing downtime. And we're seeing customers in retail, as well as wholesale and suppliers and logistics companies as examples, as well as hospitals, leveraging wireless backup solutions for failover redundancy. Importantly, we won't just deploy the service until we know that we can guarantee 100 megabit bandwidth. So it's not just best effort, but it's actually a corporate grade solution with minimum bandwidth requires and rebates. And customers can also get access to reporting, which can provide monthly SLA performance of each of the EEW services so you can monitor the uptime. And finally on this slide, there's the last box, which is field workers, which is all about how EEW can support your mobile staff as well as your assets. And we know that 5G can improve employee experience by up to 10 times with faster speeds, allowing remote staff and field and operational workers who are on the ground to collaborate and access high bandwidth apps with ease. And with EEW, your workforce can connect over Telstra's robust network while you monitor onboard usage and productivity. And in construction and mining industries, again, as an example, workers, as well as assets, by the way, connected via IoT, can all have access to high availability and low latency connectivity, backed up, as I've mentioned, by the SLAs. So on that point, I'd like to hand over to Phil McSherry, the Chief Technology Officer for MobileCorp, who's going to take us through specifically the EEW solution. So Phil, over to you.
Thanks, David. Now, I just want to take a bit of a deeper dive into what's included in the 5G enhanced enterprise wireless solution. But before we do, we'd like to take a look at the results of our second poll. What do you estimate downtime would cost your business per hour? As you can see, most people have put their unsure what is going to be the cost, right? And that's probably a very standard response amongst all enterprises, with only sort of 10% saying it's going to cost them more than $500,000 in lost man time and hours. So that's actually quite interesting. But a lot of factors need to be taken into account when you're estimating the cost of downtime. Of course, there's monetary losses, and that will vary by industry. The actual duration of the outage is also going to impact on how much that's going to cost you and the number of people that are impacted, and also the time of day that the outage occurs. Gartner says that 81% of companies that they surveyed believe that 1 hour of downtime cost their businesses between over $300,000, while 98% agree that a single hour downtime cost them over $100,000. For enterprises, 33% reported that 1 hour of downtime cost their firms between $1 and $5 million. As an aside, another finding from Gartner is that organizations tend to severely underestimate the amount of time it will take to get back online. Why are we asking about downtime? Because EEW is a business continuity solution, an insurance policy, if you like, against the cost of downtime. It's not the only use case, but it's certainly a compelling use case for mission critical businesses. We just go on to the next slide. This slide reiterates the four key issues of EEW. First up is a network availability guarantee of 99.9% backed by a monetary rebate. This demonstrates Telstra's confidence in its reliability of the 5G network and allows organizations to move ahead with confidence that a 5G link is as robust as a fixed line alternative. Secondly, the EEW solution utilizes class-leading Cradlepoint hardware. The Cradlepoint Outdoor W2005 5G wideband adapter is installed alongside a Telstra selected antenna and acts as a 5G gateway, allowing existing routers to be retained and avoiding costly infrastructure changes. Thirdly, a cloud management portal is provided to each EEW customer. This provides visibility and transparency around the performance of the 5G network and underpins the EEW uptime guarantee. Finally, included in the solution is a comprehensive managed service provided by MobileCorp. MobileCorp is a foundational Telstra enterprise partner with a shared history of more than 30 years. We're also a Platinum Mobility Partner and a Platinum Managed Service Partner, as well as a Gold Data and IP Partner. Complementing that capability, MobileCorp is also Australia's leading Cradlepoint partner and one of only 45 MSPs globally to hold the Cradlepoint 5G specialization. These accreditations, MobileCorp demonstrates our expertise. We complement that expertise with practical in-field experience through deployments with customers like Ticketek and Marine Rescue New South Wales. Now we'll look at what's included in the managed service on the next slide. the EEW managed service aims to deliver customers with three outcomes. The solution is ideally rapidly, usually deployed rapidly within 4 weeks. The minimal input and resource required from the customer. MobileCorp manages all procurement, licensing, configuration, Telstra SIM activation, on-site installation, and testing. Once deployed, the customer has full visibility of network performance, but is not required to assign resource to operational management. MobileCorp provides 24/7 network monitoring and alerting through the Cradlepoint NetCloud portal, and also provides proactive maintenance outage notifications on the rare occasion a Telstra tower may have planned maintenance. The managed network, the managed service includes troubleshooting, out-of-band device management, a device hotspot program, and a technical support desk. Thirdly, MobileCorp will be a single point of contact for all matters or issues relating to the EEW solution. Our technical support desk is manned by experienced network engineers with demonstrated experience in Telstra and Cradlepoint. We will also provide monthly reporting in line with the solution SLAs, ensuring performance transparency. Just onto the next slide. This slide demonstrates the simplicity of the enhanced enterprise wireless solution. In four short steps, taking no more than 4 weeks, the solution can be deployed and operational. Step one, eligibility of a location is confirmed by ensuring 5G signal is available. Step two, the Cradlepoint adapter and Telstra antenna are installed on site. Step three, connection to the Telstra 5G network is activated. And step four, you're up and running with MobileCorp providing expert management and support. Just on to the next slide there. In my final slide, I wanted to share you with some examples of organizations who are already taking advantage of 5G for primary or failover connectivity, or as a component of hybrid network. Primary 5G connectivity is already being used by Telstra customers, particularly in the branch, office, retail, and construction verticals. During the COVID lockdown last year, a global online exercise company set up showrooms in Martin Place, Bondi Junction, David Jones, Bourke Street, choosing Telstra 5G and Cradlepoint for their primary connectivity. At the construction of the Western Sydney Airport at Badgerys Creek, you can spy Cradlepoint outdoor adapters on a number of demand walls. Another customer is a not-for-profit in Queensland that delivers a range of health and wellbeing programs. They have recently moved 12 branch offices to primary 5G connectivity and will also use 5G for their head office while their building is being renovated. When renovation is complete, their primary 5G link will be converted to a business continuity failover link. For failover connectivity, this is a popular case for EEW with providing 5G as a diverse link for mission-critical businesses. When council workers dug up the fibre outside of one of Melbourne's most prestigious private schools last year, all internet access was lost for more than 8 hours, with online learning coming to a halt. The school has since moved to install 5G as failover at its other Australian campuses. Telstra 5G and Cradlepoint is also the failover solution for a helicopter base at La Perouse and for a nationwide manufacturer of commercial and industrial textiles. Now, what do we mean by hybrid network? Simply put, a hybrid network makes use of multiple communication standards. In this case, it's fixed internet services such as fibre and Telstra 5G technologies. We've seen great outcomes with Marine Rescue New South Wales and Ticketek using this architecture within their networks. 5G and Cradlepoint has enabled Marine Rescue New South Wales to connect remote sites back into their network in remote locations where fixed services were unavailable. And for Ticketek, it has enabled them to reduce their reliance on venue infrastructure and give them greater visibility and control over their network edge. I hope that gives you a little more detail about what EEW offers and how 5G Wireless WAN can be used to support your mission-critical businesses. I'll now hand back to David.
All right. Thank you, Phil. I'm conscious of time, so want to try and leave some time for questions. But before we go there, just on the next slide, I'd just like to very quickly share two special offers that we're offering to the attendees of today's webinar. And firstly, we're offering a free site feasibility assessment to the first five customers that sign up to Enhanced Enterprise Wireless. And secondly, customers who take up the EEW service for five sites or more will also receive a free SLA component of the service for one location, free for 3 months, and that's valued at $627. So two offers just to attendees of today. Reach out to us if you would like more information. All right, let's quickly go to questions. So if we just go to the next page. Again, there was the Slido. Hopefully everyone's got the code. A couple of questions have come up so far. We have our Slido moderator. I'm just gonna quick shout out Mark Campbell, who's on the call. And we're also supported by Telstra's EEW product manager, Barath Raghunathan, who's also on the call to answer questions. So Mark, looks like there's a couple of questions so far.
Yeah, I might point the first one at yourself, Dave, if that's all right. I know you touched on our 5G coverage in one of your slides. So it's a question here, typically difficult to serve locations that don't have 5G coverage. What's Telstra's roadmap to improve this?
All right, look, as you say, I kind of touched on it before. Firstly, what I'd say, 4G is going to continue to play a prominent role as we continue to evolve our 5G roadmap. So let's not forget what we've got around 4G. Standalone and our whole 5G footprint will certainly evolve and improve over the next 12 to 18 months. I mentioned at the beginning, 77.5% population today, 80% by June, and we're looking by June 25 to get to 95%. So hopefully that answers the question. Again, if you've got further details, come back to us, happy to share more detail, but 4G is critically important and we are investing heavily to grow 5G. We see coverage as really a key differentiator and so important around the 5G offering.
Great. I think the next one we might point to Barath, who's on the call from Telstra. Barath, how can technology, carrier and path diversity and network resilience be realistically achieved with 5G?
Hi everyone, can you hear me?
Yep.
Hi everyone, Bharat here, the from products. Look, it's a great question, but it's got a few things. Let me unpack a few things. So it's how can technology, carrier, and path diversity and network resilience be achieved with 5G? So I think as David touched on, today our focus has been on let's get the sub six and improve the network coverage. Today's 5G is also leveraging a lot of the 4G. It's 5G non standalone. But as we move towards 5G standalone, which is a key thing, for us to get into that path diversity and network resilience, because that's where we'll start to see a lot of the core and the APIs, which evolve, and we can start to use them as we start to expose, our levers out to third party platforms, and the use cases that would come along, would be humongous. But also on the resiliency, 5G standalone, and as we move towards true blue 5G, it's also a bridge towards the fixed convergence. Not saying substitution, but 5G is really, it's all about convergence, right? It's kind of making it connectivity agnostic, and it will be as resilient as fixed in some cases.
Okay. All right. I think we've probably got time for one or two more questions. I think we might aim this one at either Phil or yourself, Barath. What does a site feasibility assessment entail? I know David just talked about that offer at the end there, but can you just talk through what the assessment, what entails there?
Sure. Look, again, a good question. It would entail four things to look for as part of the site feasibility or the SQ, which is service qualification. First and foremost, is there 5G coverage available generally? Is the site not heritage listed? Is there sufficient primary 5G and 4G coverage based on local radio conditions? As I touched on, today's 5G is non-standalone is a combination of 4G and 5G. And then we would look for redundancy based on the 5G and 4G coverage based on local data conditions. But it's primarily about, how, and then of course the overlapping cell towers. So that's another one that we look for as part of the 5G base stations.
Right. And got one here. How do I use this as a failover with my MPLS network?
Happy to take that. Okay. Good question. Yes. I mean, the answer is, we can get into the how, but in principle, you can use it as a failover with the MPLS network, and that's using a private APN over the Telstra network. We have tested this as part of our co-creation. So we create, EW is a co-creation exercise with one of our with a few customers, and part of that we have tested that, and it works pretty well.
Okay. This is a fairly technical one here. Does the service provide a static IP address?
Look, it's a great question. I'll have to come back on that one.
Okay. No worries. I think that's really it, guys, from a question point of view. I'll give it back to David to wrap up.
Great last question. I haven't seen Barath stump before, so whoever's asked that question, extra brownie points. So that's the first that I've seen. All right, look, at this point, we're really at the end of the webinar, so on the last slide, I just wanted to thank everybody for attending. If you've got more questions that we didn't get to, or if you've suddenly got a question that pops into your mind as you're about to fall asleep tonight, if you want more information on the special offer, or around broadly the EEW solution, reach out to your client partner at Telstra. We're going to share this presentation as well as the recording of the webinar in the next few days. So if you've got colleagues who missed out and you feel would benefit from learning all about 5G Wireless WAN, share it with them. So thank you on behalf of MobileCorp and Cradlepoint and Telstra. Just wanted to thank everybody for attending today. Thanks, everyone.
Bye.
Thank you.